Hey, hey, God bless everyone. Sammy D, of course, sitting in the comfort of my mobile, enjoying myself in the presence of the love. Now, it's a rainy day. Raindrops keep falling on my head. It's a rainy day in New York. Oh, is it Georgia? Well, it's raining here in New York, and I love the rain. The rain reminds me of romance. Romance with life, romance with nature, and of course, love. The love of God. I kind of enjoy it. I sit in my car and I hear it when it hits the roof of my car, and I kind of enjoy that moment. It's a moment of getting closer to nature and closer to God, of course. But I have a concern in my heart, and I want to bring to you this message that I believe will help you. And it's a concern that our generation today is facing. So I want to address our culture and our society and our generation, particularly the believer in Christ Jesus. And I'm reading from the book of Matthew's in my Bible, chapter 6, verse 33, when Jesus says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Seek first the government of God, the rulership of God, and to be in right standards with God. And then the other things of life will come to you. God will provide them for us. He'll give us the ability to create wealth, give us the strength to get to our jobs and to run our business or ministry, but he'll add things to us. But my concern with our society is that we're living in an age and in a time, and it's been going on for some years now, that the social media, our modern technology, have gotten a hold of us. Yes, a stronghold of us. Control. It's gotten to a point where it governs us. It says, seek first the kingdom of God, the government of God, the rulership of God, the reign of God. But our social medias today, our modern technology, has taken that place where it governs, it controls, it rules us. And we're like, you know, those old cartoons where the mouse was playing the fiddle, the flute, the piccolo, and the mice would just follow, and then he'll drum to his cave or his cage, and he entrapped them. And that's what the social media, if you're not careful, if you don't use it for the right things, to use it for the glory of God and to promote the gospel, if we're not careful, we're being bombarded by it and we're in bondage to it. I'm talking about our culture, our generation, and society as a whole. I was walking down the street yesterday, and there was a gentleman on his phone. Obviously, he was texting, and he was just paying attention to his phone, and he almost ran into me, and I jumped out the way, and I said, "Hey!" And he didn't even see me or hear me. He just kept texting. And he's the type of guy that would run right into a Mack truck. Ping! Won't even see it coming. We go to a restaurant on Valentine's Day, a day for friendship, for lovers. You take your honey out, or your honey takes you out, and you go to a restaurant, and instead of talking about each other and the love that's in the air and the romance and the moment, we're texting. We're checking our social media out. Don't have time for each other. We go to a dinner table. It used to be when the family would get together and we'll talk and make some jokes and talk about Uncle Charlie and about one another and just have a good fellowship, a good time of socializing. Now we're at the dinner table texting or checking out our social media from the youngest to the oldest. We don't have time to talk to each other. We're eating without even looking at the food. You're just picking up something and putting it in your mouth because you're too busy looking at the phone. I see it. You see it. We've been talking about this. It's been going on for a while. Go to the movie house. They have to put it up on the screen. Please, shut your phones off. Go to a funeral home. Instead of paying your respect and honoring the person that passed away or the family of the ones that lost a loved one, we're too busy texting and on the phone and not paying attention to people's mourning and grieving or their pain. I've seen it in church. Gone that far. I've seen the choir sing, and once they sit down, they take their phones out and they're texting. I ain't paying attention to the message, just texting away. I've seen preachers before they go to preach or pastors, they take their phone out and they're texting on the way to the pulpit or making a call or checking their phone out. I won't be surprised if one day in a wedding, the bride and the groom are up there, the minister, the reverend, the pastor, the priest is ready to pronounce them man and wife. Do you take this man or do you take this woman? Can you hold a second, please? Take your phone out and you start texting. Say, okay, where were we? We're driving. While you're driving, you're texting. You're not paying attention to where you're going. Boom, running into accidents. Unfortunately, somebody else gets hurt. We're living in that time and age where the social media has bombarded us and we're being captive by it. We're being controlled by it. In schools, in our jobs, ministry, business. You go to buy something and you're on your phone or you're texting and can I help you with, let me have a container of milk and wait a minute, where were we? Who are you? Why am I in here? We're being controlled by this and there's the negative side of that. And if we're not careful, listen to me, Christians, believers, those that are washed in the blood, those that are hungry for God, those that are in love with the Lord, we get caught up with that. And before we go to the throne, we go to the phone. And instead of spending time with God and seeking God's face, particularly in the morning when you start your day, we're too busy checking out who called me, who texted me, who am I going to get in touch with? Facebook, YouTube, Twitter account. We're too busy in our social media connection that we forget our Heavenly Father's connection. Somebody said that the greatest tragedy in the world is to forsake God and never miss him. For a Christian, can you imagine that? You don't miss him. You don't miss spending time with him, praying, waiting on him. And that is a problem. A major problem that I'm concerned about and our love for our generation, particularly Christians, to put their phones away, put their account away, their social media account, and just seek the face of God. Jesus says, seek first the kingdom of God. Before you go to your phone, go to the throne and seek God and be hungry for God and talk to God and wait upon God. You know, God created the first wireless phone. You say, really, Sam? Where? Jeremiah 33:3. Jeremiah 33:3, he said, call upon me and I will answer you. Call upon God. God wants to talk to you. He wants to talk to us. Listen, before I preach this message on this video, I preach it to me. Sammy D, seek first the kingdom of God. Because I got caught up with that stuff. And I have a Facebook account and a YouTube account. I'm not into, I can't even pronounce it right. Traitor. The president probably can pronounce it better than I could. But I'm not into that one, but I don't want to get into anything else. I've come here to preach the gospel and to put up posters that have to do with the Lord, to draw people closer to God and bring God closer to the people. And I keep my focus on that. But we got into a place, man, where we're all over the place with our social media. And we forgot God and we forsook him. We neglected God. We neglected to seek the face of God. Let me ask you a question. How much time do you spend in the presence of God compared to the time you spend on your phone, on your social media account? Sam, don't go there. Ask yourself that. You spend minutes, hours, half a day, on your phone, on your Twitter account, or your Facebook, or YouTube? Do you spend hours before the Lord? Or minutes? Or no minutes at all? I haven't talked to him in a few days. Ask yourself that. And if your answer is, man, I said, I'm in trouble, then do something about that. You know what I've done? The last month or so, take my phone, I shut it off at night, I put it away. Put it in the drawer. I don't want to touch it. I don't want to look at it. I want to get up and go before the throne of God and seek God. I don't know how long it's going to take, half an hour, 2, 3 hours. And when I'm finished with the Lord, then I'll check my phone. I don't even have limitations on that. I'll do a video, put it on social media. I want you to get blessed with it. I hope you do. And then I'll leave it alone. And I don't want to get hooked up on that. I want to detox from that. And here's my major problem is when I see pastors up in the pulpit and preachers and evangelists, and they have to go up there with their phone, their tablets, their iPhone, iPod, and they have to read the scriptures on that. I'm not against that. Listen, if you do that, praise God, you're on time, you're on top of your game, you're in the crowd, you're in the modern movement, and that's good for you if you can do that. I haven't done that. I have no interest. I like to take my Bible to church. I'm not better than you. I'm probably worse than you. That's why I got to get really into the Lord, man. I take my phone. I leave it in my car. I want to keep my Bible. I want to turn the pages. I want to write on my scripture. I want to know what the Bible says. See, I saw a man a long time ago. He was a preacher, and he went up to preach, and he forgot his notes. Forgot his notes. And he went up there, and he looked in his Bible, and he couldn't find his notes. And he said, listen, I'm sorry. I can't preach. I don't have my notes. Forgot his notes. Couldn't preach. Well, he should have had the word inside of him. He should have known what he was going to preach, and he should have studied that and prepared himself to have it inside his heart. The Bible says in Psalm 119, that word have I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against you. Memorize scriptures. There's going to come a time, and I want to say this prophetically, there's going to come a time, and probably it's here already, where we're not going to be able to quote from the scriptures and read the word. Our society, our generation, our culture has sold out, and they don't put God first. And here in America, we owe so much money, and the Chinese and other cultures have come and taken over, and they own at least 40% of the land and property in the United States. And other cultures have come, and we've taken God out of the picture. We took him out of schools. We've taken him out of public buildings. We've taken him out of governmental buildings. We don't say Merry Christmas anymore. Now it's Happy Holidays. Take Jesus out of the holiday. Remove Jesus from anything that has to do with anything that is sacred. Remove him. Take him out. And there's going to come a time, and again, I want to say this prophetically, where we're not going to be able to gather and praise and worship and talk about Jesus because other cultures have come in. And they presented their God or their belief or their system, which is a humanistic system, a new age movement, and they're going to rip that right from us. But I got news for you. The church of the living God will prevail. The Bible will always be around. You'll never get rid of it. But I want to challenge every believer, every pastor. If you have a pastor and you hear this message, send it to him. Send it to others. Make it go viral so that others can see it and hear it, that you and I need to not only read the word and meditate, but memorize the scriptures, because you may not be able to show up with a Bible somewhere. You may not be able to quote, rather to read from the Bible. You have to quote from it. You have to have the word inside of you so you can tell the story, so you can prophesy, so you can preach, so you can reach, so you can teach, and let others know about the stories of Jesus. Let me tell you something, my friend. You need to memorize the word of God and have it in your heart. You shouldn't always come up with your cell phone or your tablet, because what if it doesn't work? What if you forget it? What if it breaks? What if you just lost it? What if you can't find the scripture? What are you going to do then? You should have it in your heart. You should be able to say, turn with me if you have your Bibles, your tablets, or your phone, to Romans chapter 1 verse 16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God unto salvation. You have to excuse me, I'm a little bit under the weather. You should be able to quote the word of God. You should be able to go into, if you have your Bibles, your tablets, or your phones, go with me to Romans chapter 5. And as you're walking up and down, you can quote that. Justified by faith, we have peace. We have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. You should go to Romans chapter 8, verse 28. All things work together for good to those that love God. You should go to Romans chapter 8, verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. And then you come down to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 18. 1 Corinthians, it says, for the preaching of the gospel is foolishness to those that perish, but is the power of God unto salvation to those that believe. You should be able to go down to 1 Corinthians where Paul the apostle says in the first chapter and the second chapter, for my preaching and my speech was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of power and of the Holy Spirit. I'm quoting, I'm memorizing. You should memorize. You should quote. If you leave your notes home, if your tablet don't work, if your phones break, you should be able to say, listen, go with me to 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Romans. Go with me to John 1:1. You should quote it. The beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. Hallelujah. You should go down a little further to John chapter 1, verse 12. He came unto his own, who he, Jesus, came to his own, but his own received them not, but as many, and as many, the big, the small, the ugly, the mean, the lean, the far, the near, as many as received them, to them he gave the power to become children of God, the privilege, the opportunity, the right to become sons of daughters of God. You should be able to go to John chapter 20, verse 20. It says, then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord after the resurrection. When they saw the Lord, they were glad. You should be able to go to Romans chapter 1, verse 8. You shall receive, Jesus is speaking. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. When the Holy Spirit, and you'll be able to go out and preach the word of God, Judea and Jerusalem and all over the world. You should be able to go down to 1 John 1:9. When you're talking to sinners, you say, listen, if you confess your sin, he is faithful and just to forgive you of all your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. You should be able to go to Philippians chapter 4 and verse 4 and minister to some Christians that are sad and depressed. You should be able to tell them, you know, the Bible says, rejoice in the Lord. And again, I say rejoice. It was written by a man named Paul in prison. He's telling people to rejoice while he's in the dungeon of the prison. You should be able to go to the same book of Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. I can do all things to Christ, which strengthens me. Not half things, not some things. I can do anything that God tells me I can do. I am who God says that I am. You should be able to go to 2 Timothy for those that are fearing and those that are bound by the spirit of fear, and Goliath is putting fear in your heart. You should be able to go to 2 Timothy and chapter 1, verse 7. For God has not given me the spirit of fear. He gave me something. He put it in my hand, but it wasn't the spirit of fear. It was the spirit of love, of power, and of a sound mind. You should be able to quote the scriptures and have it inside of you and meditate on the word of God. You should be able to walk in the spirit of the Lord and be ready. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2. Paul the apostle tells Timothy, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, do the work of an evangelist, be ready. Man, one day I was in my church, listen to me, I was in my church, the old church I came out of. I was there for practically 30 years, and my pastor comes up to me and says, Sammy, the preacher's not showing up, can you preach this morning? Sunday morning. I went there to worship. He said, can you preach? Now, just imagine if I wasn't ready. I would say, well, Pastor, give me an hour. Let me go downstairs and fast, although I just had breakfast. Let me pray. Let me look. Let me see what I'm going to preach about. I got to get the dust out of here. You know what I told him? I said, sure, Pastor, just give me the mic. Give me the mic. A baseball player needs to be ready. He may be sitting in the bench. They never called you. But one day, the manager comes up, listen, I need you to go up there and hit the ball, man. And what? Hit? Anybody got a bat I can borrow? How do you swing this bat? Basketball player should be ready. You've been benched all this time. Just sitting on the bench. Sammy, I need you up there, man. I want you to go in there. What? How do you bounce this ball? I'm joking, but you should be ready in season and out of season. If you're a singer for God, be ready to sing. Have your music ready. One day they may call you. Put it in there and sing. You don't have time to goggle. Oh, la, 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 la. Just go up there and do it. If you play an instrument, have your instrument in. Whatever it is. Be ready. Be ready. Time is coming, man. Persecution is here. We got to be ready, man. Have that word inside of you. Preach it. Teach it. Reach with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We should be ready. You should know Acts chapter 10, verse 38. How Jesus Christ was anointed with power. The spirit. And he went around doing good and healing all that was sick. Why? Because God was with him. You should be able to quote scriptures, have it inside of you. You should be able to quote Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, not was, not will be, but is right now. My shepherd, I shall not want. You should be able to quote Psalm 27. The Lord is the light of my life, and who should I be afraid? You should be able to quote Psalm 91. He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my rock, my strength, my fortress. You should be able to know these scriptures. You should be able to quote Psalm 1. Blessed is the man or the woman, little boy, little girl that walks out in the counsel of the ungodly and not sit in the sinners or scoundrels. You should be able to know the scripture. That's why David said, your word I hid. I put it in my heart, man, that I may not sin. Your word is a light lamp unto my feet, my path. You should know these stories. You should be able to talk about Moses without having to go into your scripture. You should quote them, memorize them. Moses came from behind the bushes and he came and had a burning bush experience behind the desert. God said, go to Pharaoh and tell him that I said, let my people go. You should know where to find that in the book of Exodus chapter 4. You should be able to talk about Jacob when he wrestled with God. He said, I won't let you go until you bless me. Then he blessed him, changed his name, changed his walk, changed his character. He was a conniver, a thief, a liar, and he changed and transformed. You should be able to talk about Joseph when his brothers sold him because he had this coat of many colors. He was bragging about where he was going in life. He was going to reign. People were going to bow before him. He had authority. He had spiritual authority. He had a coat of righteousness, and they took that coat from him. They couldn't fit it because what God has for you, nobody else can put it on. Nobody else can fit into your shoes. Nobody else can fit into your anointing. Nobody else can fit into your calling. It belongs to you. They threw him in a pit. They took him out and sold him to Potiphar as a slave. And Potiphar's wife, young lady, said, man, my husband's too busy out there with the soldiers, man. He ain't taking care of business. He ain't doing what he needs to do at home. I'ma get this young man. And she tried to get him and rape him. And he ran and left his coat behind. There goes that coat again. It couldn't fit anybody else. It belonged to him. And they put him in prison. And some years later, he went from the prison to the palace because he interpreted dreams. You should be able to speak about that without having to go into the scripture, because you read it and you memorize it. You should be able to talk about Elijah the prophet in the book of Kings, when he challenged the prophets of Baal and said, you call on your God, I'll call on my God, and the God that answers by fire, we're going to serve that God. He repaired the altar, and when he called on his God, his God answered by fire. He knew that his God was going to do the miracle, and the people turned back to God and said, God is God, and him only will we serve. You should be able to talk about Jeremiah's calling. When God called him as a child, he said, I'm too young, I can't speak. And God rebuked him and said, don't say that. Don't say you're too young. Listen, my friend, you might be feeling like you're too young. You got a self-image problem, a complex. You don't feel you're educated enough. You're tall enough. You're too small. You're too big. You're too lean. You're too mean. But God has called you, and God will put his word in you like he did for Jeremiah. And he said, I'm going to make you like a fortified city, and I'm going to put my words in you. He took coal, put it in his mouth, and Jeremiah preached. And one time when Jeremiah said, I don't want to preach anymore, he was in the prison, in the dungeon, he said, your words are shut up in me like fire, and I've got to preach this gospel. You should be able to talk about Daniel in the lion's den. When another lion showed up, the lion from the tribe of Judah, and protected Daniel. You should be able to talk about the three Hebrew boys, my shack, your shack, and a billy goat. When they put him in the fire, you know that wasn't their name, but I'm just kidding. They put him in the fire, and they raised up the furnace. And the king said to one of the servants, listen here, man, didn't you throw three dudes in there? Three cats? Didn't you throw three Hebrew boys in there? Yeah, I did. How come I see four of them? And one of them looks like the Son of Man. He was a fireman, puts out the fire. They came out, they didn't even smell like smoke. You should be able to memorize, study, and meditate on that word. You should be able to, like God told Joshua. In Joshua chapter 1 verse 9, he says, if you follow me, if you obey me, meditate on my word, then you will be successful. Meditate on the word of God, because there's going to come a time when your tablet's not going to work, your cell phone's not going to work, your iPhone's not going to work. You won't have the Bible because persecution is coming and they'll try to eliminate it, and you're going to have to stand up somewhere and talk about the word that's inside of you. Let the word be in you and let it come out like fire. Let it flow in you. You should be able to talk about Isaiah the prophet, chapter 61, when he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he's anointed me to preach the word, to heal the broken heart, to preach to the poor, and to bring salvation to the nation. This is the prophecy of Jesus. You should be able to talk about Isaiah chapter 53. When he said, who's believed that report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? He shall be like a root coming out of a dry ground. Stripes were healed. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. The government is on his shoulder. He's carrying the government. This is the Jesus that we know. I want to know him. Forget about the cell phone. Forget about social media. Put that aside for now. Don't be part of that generation. Don't be part of that culture that's caught up with all that and is bound by that. Fully to that and get into the word. Seek first the kingdom of God and know him and know the power of his love. You should be able to talk about Elisha. Not Elijah, but Elisha, both of them, the double portion prophet. When he came to Elijah, said, I want double of what you got. I want what you got. Give it to me. And if you look at me, I'm going to throw my mantle at you. When he picked up the mantle, he became the prophet of the double anointing. One day in chapter 4, 2 Kings, there was a widow. He said, man, what's your problem? She said, man, my husband served you, and now he's dead, and they're coming over to take my kids because I owe money. He said, what do you got in your house? He said, I ain't got nothing but a little bit of oil. A little bit of oil? Give it to me. Bring that little bit of oil. Listen, what the little that you have is enough for God. You got a little bit of oil? Bring that little bit of oil to God. God will prosper. That's what Jesus did with the 5 loaves, the fish. He prospered it. That's what God does. He'll anoint it. He'll prosper it. Samson had just a jawbone of a donkey, and he slew is the word, right? The King James. He killed many of the enemies, the Philistines, just with a little bit of oil. The prophet said, give me that oil. Go borrow some vessels and pour the oil. Long story short, she had enough to pay off her debt, and she had enough to live. There was a drought, a famine, and she was blessed because she obeyed the prophet. If you obey God's word, if you follow the Lord will bless you. You should be able to talk about David and Goliath. When David marched, he ran, he charged the giant instead of being afraid like everybody else. Oh, he charged and he killed that giant and chopped off his head and went around showing, look what I did. You should be able to talk about any story from the Bible because you memorize it. Listen, this blind Bartimaeus, blind as a bat, he couldn't see, man. He was blind and he heard that Jesus was passing by, and he said, Jesus! And they told him, keep quiet, hush up. Many of you have been told, keep quiet, hush up. Don't cry out to God. Don't pray anymore. Don't go to church. Don't believe the word. Don't read the word. Don't meditate on the word. And you listen to that voice. This man, blind Bartimaeus, one of my favorite characters in the Bible. He could have said, yeah, I'm going to shut up. I'm not going to talk. I'm not going to cry. I'm not going to call on God. He's a beggar. That's what he does, man. He begs. He asks his people for alms, for money. They don't tell him to shut up. That's what I do. That's my profession. You play with computers. You may have a business in Wall Street. You may have a church. But my job is begging. Don't tell me to shut up. Don't ever tell a beggar to shut up. He's going to want something. Give me a dollar. I don't have a dollar. Give me 50 cents. I don't have 50 cents. Give me a quarter. I don't have a quarter. Give me a nickel. I don't have a nickel. Give me a cigarette. They're going to beg because that's what they do. When they told this man, blind Bartimaeus, hush up. He said, what? Are you crazy? Like in my neighborhood, he said, is you crazy? And he shouted the louder, Jesus, son of David. And Jesus stopped. And he said, who's that calling me? They know who I am, the son of David, man. They know my deity. Bring him over here. And they went up to him and said, cheer up. The master is calling you. Jesus healed that man. You should be able to talk about the woman with the issue of blood. You'll find that in the gospel. She couldn't get close to anybody. She had this problem with bleeding. She suffered. She was subject. And she spent everything that she had. She heard about Jesus. Somebody was talking about him. I don't know who was talking about him. Maybe it was blind Bartimaeus. He said, yeah, he healed my eyes. I can see now. Maybe it was Lazarus. He came up from the dead. He said, I was dead, but now I'm alive. But she heard the testimony. And she said to herself, if I get close enough to him and I just pull, he don't have to touch me. Let me get close to him. Let me just pull on his garment. I need my blessing. I need my miracle. I need my healing. And she pulled and she got healed immediately. And Jesus said, who touched me? The disciples said, everybody's touching you, Master. No. Somebody touched me with faith. Do you have that kind of faith where in your congregation, everybody just sitting there business as usual, just listening to the message and probably thinking about the food that they're going to eat when they get home. Hurry up, say, man, I want to get out of here. But you came in there with an agenda, man. I need my healing. I need my miracle. And you touch God and he sends a miracle your way with your name on it. You should be able to talk about, and I'll finalize with it, the woman that had the problem, but she was hunchback sitting in the back of the church. You couldn't even look up. She was hunchback. Sitting in the synagogue, business as usual. I'm going to hear the rabbi talk. He's going to say a few things, and then we're going to get out of here. And Jesus saw her. She didn't see him because she was bowed down. Jesus saw her and called her, yoo-hoo, lady, talking to me. I think he's talking to you. He wants you up there. Really? And she walked up there like this, hunchback. And Jesus then asked her, question, how'd you get like that? What happened to you? You're not following the Mosaic law? You're not keeping all the rituals? You're not listening to the Pharisees like many of church folks do? When they see you strung out, down and out, you're down so low you can't see the... You have to look up to see the bottom, and they question you. How'd you get like that? You should have listened. You should have never left the church. You should have never ran out. You should have been paying attention. Jesus didn't ask her no question. He just said, woman, you're loose from your infirmity. And he healed her, and he touched her. That's the God that we serve. I don't know about your Jesus. I don't know about your gospel. The gospel that I know is good news, healing, deliverance. He restores. He increases. He lifts you up. He loves you. Embraces you. You should be able to talk about the prodigal son when he took his stuff and went out and he sat down with the pigs. And then one day he came to his senses, I got to get back to my father's house. And he went back and his father embraced him. And father, instead of his father saying, what are you doing coming back here? You stink, man. You smell like swine. You smell like liquor. Like many of us do. We point fingers. We say, yeah, I know you. I heard about you. What are you? Listen to me, bimbo. Embrace. Love. Do what God did for you. You were out there smelling like the pigs, sinning. You say, me? Yeah, that's what argue with God. Romans chapter 3, verse 23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I mean, how dare you point a finger? You ain't got no business. You got to talk to the woman that was caught in adultery. Say, yeah, listen, lady. What happened? You were caught in adultery. Yeah, well, I went to Jesus, man. What did he say? He wrote on the ground and he told me, where are those that accuse you? Yeah, whoever has no sin, throw the first stone. They all ran away. And Jesus said to me, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. I fell in love with Jesus. And that's what you ought to do with people. Instead of condemning them, throwing stones, you should be like the woman at the well. Jesus said, yeah, you got five husbands. The one you have is not yours. How do you know that? You must be a prophet. Jesus said, drink of my waters. If you only knew. She got saved and she went out and preached. Do like the man that was demon-possessed in the mountains crying. The time would change. He breaks and cuts himself with stones. Jesus went over to the other side. And as he was going over, the stone came. And Jesus said, man, I ain't got time for you. Peace, be still. And he went up to that man and says, told the demons, come out of that man. Set him free. That man went out and evangelized. He preached. And he's five little cities, regions, got saved behind his preaching, behind his testimony. You ought to be like that. I ought to be like that. Get into the Lord. Seek the face of God. Memorize scriptures. Know them. Quote them. Be able to talk about the Lord. Don't be like that man that left his notes home and said, I can't preach. I don't have my notes. You head knowledge. I want heart knowledge. God wants heart knowledge from us. He wants you to know the word inside of you and tell the story of the greatest love of all. I'm crying. crying out to this generation, to this culture, to Christians. Get right with God. Seek first His face. We're coming into those days, man. There's places where they already have chips. Can't open the door to your job. You got to clock in with your chip. They're experimenting. You can't buy. You can't sell. We're coming to those days, man. Stop being like everything is jolly and tiptoeing through the tulips. And please don't squeeze the shaman Christianity. Get serious, man. There's joy, of course. There's time of rejoicing. And we do when we go to church and we dance and we pray. But get into the word of God. Get into the face of God. Seek His face and listen to what does say the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, send His word. Whoever's listening to me right now, that you touch from the top of their head to the soles of their feet, that you will give us a hunger for God connection, not social media connection, to seek your face, to go to the throne before I go to the phone. In Jesus' name I pray, amen, and amen. God bless you. Love you in the Lord. Hallelujah.